Ok, bon, bonjour à toutes, bonjour à tous. Eh bien, donc aujourd'hui, nous avons le plaisir d'accueillir Raphaël Jeanneret, qui, après un postdoc à Majorque et à Warwick, est maintenant junior researcher au laboratoire de physique de l'École normale supérieure. Et il s'intéresse à la matière active, aux phénomènes collectifs et aux micro-organismes. Et donc, à toi, Raphaël.
OK, thank you, Pierre-Yves, for the introduction. So yeah, I'm Raphaël Jeanneret. And well, so I'm going to apply to the position of maître de conférence that opens here in the thematic fluids. So I would like to first introduce myself and my background. After studying at INS Lyon until 2010, I went to Paris at ESPCI to join the team of Denis Bartolo for my PhD. Which was at the interface between hydrodynamics, statistical physics, and nonlinear physics, where I studied the collective behavior of droplets in microfluidic flows. Then I moved to Warwick, as Pierre-Yves said, and there I started to be interested in microorganisms that swims. And I will talk about this part. This is going to be the main topic of my talk today. Then I moved to Spain, at IMIDEA in Mallorca. Under the supervision of Idan Tuval for my second postdoc, where we mainly studied non-motile microorganisms, which are called diatoms. And so those microorganisms, they basically spend their life moving up and down the water column in the ocean, and we were interested in the sinking, the collective sinking of suspension of those diatoms, where basically there is an hydrodynamic instability that favors the encountering between diatoms. And what we believe is that it helps them to meet for sexual reproduction. And since a year and a half now, I'm at INS with a postdoc position, which is, let's say, autonomous, where I can develop my own project. And so I'm going to say a few words on the project I have developed, still looking at microorganisms, swimming microorganisms, and that I would like to continue as a maître de conférence. So I'm just going to say a few words on this, on the main project of my PhD. Then I'll talk about the main topic of my talk, okay, active-passive mixture. And finally, I will say a few words on this. Okay, so let's start with my PhD project, which was dealing with the reversibility in periodically advected emulsions. And to introduce this topic, I should start by showing you this video, which I'm pretty sure you all know, done by G.I. Taylor in the 60s, to illustrate what is the kinematic reversibility, okay? So, which is a property of low Reynolds number flows. Okay, so here you have a very viscous oil in a cylindrical quad cells. He has put a drop of dye, which is the same liquid, only that it is dyed, okay, in red, and it's going to first turn the inner cylinder in one direction, okay, which spread the drops, okay, due to viscous forces. So here it is at three turns. It's going to stop at four turns, okay, and then it reverses the flow, basically, by turning in the other direction three times, and exactly four times turns, you get the same drop as before. Okay, so you have unmixed the system in a sense. Okay, and this is what is called kinematic reversibility. Okay, so basically when you inverse the boundary condition of on the system, you inverse the velocity field. Okay, but you get exactly the same velocity field. And the question we had is, what about this kind of property, reversibility in systems of particles which are in hydrodynamic interaction? Here it's not the case. The molecule of dye, they do not interact hydrodynamically. Okay. And so I built the microfluidic setup, which is shown here, quite advanced. Okay, and there are many things here. But what you should see is here there is a flow focusing device, which is this kind of device, zooming in, which allows to produce a monodisperse emulsion at quite a high frequency. And this is real time. Okay. And those drops, they are sent into this big chamber whose thickness is basically the size of the drop. Okay, so you have a quasi-2D system. Once the chamber is completely full of droplets, meaning 500,000 droplets about, we stop the production of drops, and then we apply a sinusoidal flow to the system, as you will see here. Okay, so we advect back and forth the system. And this is a plug flow. Okay, so all the droplets, they, on average, are advected with the same flow. Okay, but as you can see, they do not move straight. Okay, they also have a motion in this direction. Okay, which is exemplified in this trajectory. Okay, this means that there are hydrodynamic interaction between the droplets. Okay, they disturb the flow, the main flow, and so they disturb the motion of the other droplets. And you can quantify the control parameter is basically the amplitude delta here at which you advect during alpha cycle the system. And then you want to look at the strop dynamics. Okay, after one full cycle, where the droplet shear has moved. Okay, and so you can quantify by looking at the trajectories on the strop dynamics. You can quantify the diffusion, for instance, along the flow direction. And what you can see is that depending on the amplitude, you have a discontinuous transition here, where below this amplitude, the diffusion stays really small, while above, it takes values that are quite important. And you will see that the outcome is quite different. So at low diffusion here, low amplitude, you don't have any mixing in the system. Okay, all the droplets, they stay basically at the same space, at the same place. While above this transition, you have a strong mixing, okay, between the droplets. While here, from here to here, you have changed the amplitude of only 2%. Okay, so it's really small effect, but a huge, a small change, but a huge effect. Okay, so here you have a reversible state, irreversible state, and you have a discontinuous dynamical transition between the two at this delta star. Okay, and basically, the reason for that is that here you have a system of many particles which are in the interaction. So you have a chaotic system, and in this region of the space, this chaoticity is kind of limited. I'm not going to enter into the detail, but this it's related to the self-organization of the emulsion, the structural self-organization. While above, here the chaoticity is quite important, and you have a strong mixing due to basically amplification of all minute irreversible processes that can be in this experimental system. And looking at the structure, as I said, we have, in fact, a self-organization as we increase delta from low amplitude to just before the transition. And above, you see that here the feeling is much more homogeneous, okay, than here. Here it's completely random. While here it's random with some structural feature at the end. It's basically, it's a structure where the density fluctuation are smaller than for a pure random system. And this kind of system is called hyperuniform. Okay, because well, the feeling is much more homogeneous, and those kind of structure are quite interesting for their optical properties. Okay, so it was quite surprising to see this, it's kind of the first experimental system where we do have hyperuniform structure that emerge. Okay. So that's all I wanted to say on this. If you are interested in those questions, you can find those publications, and I can discuss it afterwards. Okay, so let's go back to the main topic of our talk today, which is about physics, some physics about colloidal active-passive mixture, which is a project that I've been initiated at University of Warwick, but we're still working on it with my collaborators at Warwick and IMEDEA. Okay, so the kind of system we consider is the following. So we're going to consider swimming microalgae like Chlamydomonas reinhardtii, so which has a 10 micron body size, two flagella that you can maybe see here beating. This is a high-speed movie, okay, taken at 500 FPS. So the beating of a flagella, it's like 50 hertz, so it's very, very rapid. Okay, so you need a high-speed camera to see it. And it swims quite fast, this microalgae, about 100 micrometers per second. And so we're going to consider this kind of system of swimming flagellated microorganism. Okay, so here you have a flask, one of my flasks, where there are many of those cells, like 50 million cells, I would say, in this flask. And so the question that we want to address is the following. Imagine that at t equals zero, you put some particle in this, passive colloids. You want to know how would the colloids be mixed by the swimming algae, okay, in this kind of system. And so you need to consider two kind of effect, let's say. You can consider the far-field hydrodynamics. So when this guy swims, it displays the fluid around. Okay, so it transfers momentum to any kind of particle that is in the fluid. But you can also consider collision, so much more shorter interaction. And we'll see the influence of both of those effects. Okay, so we're not the only one that have been interested in this kind of situation. But in the past, say 10 years, there has been a growing interest in the interaction between active entities like microswimmers and passive objects suspended in solution, okay, which is schematized here. So you want to know what is the dynamics of a passive particle, which is in a field of force of active forces that is that depends on space and time. Okay, that's basically the kind of system we consider. And this is interesting for different reasons. First of all, because it's a nice instance of out-of-equilibrium statistical mechanics. So to advance this field and get some, let's say, general principles. There are some possible direct technological applications. So people in active matter community think about using active particles to microactivate or deliver drugs to some specific part of the body. These kind of things. You can think of directing the self-assembly of passive particles, doping the system with active particles. You can also think of using active particles to depollute water and this kind of stuff. And the last reason is that there are many instances which are in biology and ecology where this kind of active-passive system occur. Okay, you can think of microbial grazing, when a predator needs to eat a prey, infection by viruses, but also inside the cell, the transport of proteins, of organelles, is often mediated by active forces. Okay. Okay, so if we come back to the system we are interested in, so microswimmers and passive colloids. Let's first focus on the effect of the far-field hydrodynamics. So this will be like kind of an introduction. It's not stuff that I've done. Okay. The thing that I brought, thing that I discovered, is more on the collision part. Okay. So to tackle this problem, we first need to know what is the hydrodynamic associated to a flagellated microswimmer. So here I show you a movie of bacteria, the most famous one, E. coli, done by Howard Berg, where you see that it moves using a flagellar bundle that rotates, okay, and like a corkscrew, it's gonna move the body forward. Here you again have Chlamydomonas that do a breaststroke, okay. And another one, Oxyris marina, which is a dinoflagellate. So it's also a phytoplankton, but it can eat this kind of microorganism. So it's a predator. And it moves by propagating wave along its flagella, okay, like a sperm cell would do. And I show you this also to show you that they are quite efficient at swimming, which is quite normal. I mean, they live in liquid, so they've been kind of optimized for this. But a typical ratio to keep in mind is that the velocity to their size is about 10 seconds minus 1. Okay, so they move 10 body size per second. It's the kind of ratio that you need to keep in mind. Okay, so it's very fast. If you think of humans, we don't go higher than 1 second minus one. Okay. All right. So now, what is the hydrodynamics associated to these guys? So this is the flow field measured for this guy, Chlamydomonas reinhardtii. It has been done in Cambridge in the group of Rigolstein 10 years ago. And it's done by doing PTV, so particle tracking velocimetry. So you put colloids around and you track the motion of the algae, you track the motion of the colloids around, and so you can reconstruct the flow field like this. And here what you can see, there are two features. First one is that the fluid is pumped at the back and at the front, and it is ejected on the side. And the second feature is that you have a stagnation point here. Okay. And in order to try to model this flow field, you should first realize that typical Reynolds number associated to the motion of this guy is very small, okay, of the order of 10 minus 3. And so this means that you are in the limit of the overdamped dynamics, which means that at any time on this system, the forces, I mean, it's a force-free system, okay? So all the forces that apply on this system are zero. The sum is zero. Meaning that at each time, the force that is applied from the flagella, the stress force, is compensated by the drag force, which we are going to write as F. And so now from the fluid point of view, this means that you can reconstruct this flow field by solving the Stokes equation for point forces representing the two flagella and the drag force on the body. And those three forces, their sum is exactly zero. Okay, so if you solve this for each of those three forces and then add the velocity field, you get the blue streamlines here, which resemble a lot the experimental one, meaning that the fluid is pumped at the back and at the front and ejected on the side, and you have a stagnation point here in front. Okay. So now the question is, okay, in this moving field, what is the dynamic of a colloid? Okay. And a good way to think about this first is to consider an infinite path of the microalgae, okay, and straight. Okay. Of course, this is not something that happens realistically, but it's a good way of thinking about it. And then you can integrate the dynamic of the colloid over the motion of the clammy. And what you should realize is that because of the symmetry of the far field, you should get no net displacement. You will disturb the motion of the colloid following a loop like trajectory like this. Okay, but there is no net displacement. But of course, microorganisms, they don't swim straight for infinite time. What they do, usually, is that they run, they swim for some time, a time which is distributed, which is a Poisson process, which follows a Poisson process. Then they turn, which is called a tumble. They go straight, a run, they tumble, they run, they tumble, and so on. Okay, and so they follow what is called a run and tumble kind of motion. So now if you consider only this finite path in blue, this will disturb the motion of the colloids following a loop-like trajectory, but which is open, not closed, because the path here is finite. Okay? So you have a net displacement of the colloid. And now if you add the contribution of all the algae that are in suspension, so you add all those displacements following the contribution of different algae in the suspension, which act successively on the colloid. Here we consider a dilute limit, okay, where at any time you can consider that the colloid is only perturbed by one algae. Okay? And so from this, you can expect that adding all those displacements, you're going to get enhanced diffusion of the colloid. And this has been observed experimentally, those loop-like trajectories. So this is from a recent paper done in Grenoble. At LIFI, and here you see that so the color code for the time, and as the algae pass by the colloid, you see this loop-like trajectory that induces a quite big displacement compared to simple Brownian motion. Okay, and so they've measured also the diffusivity as a function of the swimmer density for different particle size. Okay, and they also always observe a linear increase, but with a slope which is relatively small, okay, meaning that this is a small effect on the enhanced diffusion. Okay, so but now what about shorter range interaction? And this is where I brought something new. So I'm going to show you first a movie, which is slightly accelerated, if I remember well, about our experimental observation. So here you have a colloid, okay, which is not in focus, but you can still see it, which are in a bath of Chlamydomonas cells. You don't see any cells yet. Okay. So what the colloid does is Brownian motion when the algae are far away. Here you see a loop-like trajectory due to the motion of the algae nearby. And now you're going to see something new here, okay, where you saw a very large displacement where the colloid kind of followed the path of a microalgae. Okay. So the question we have is what is the origin of this large displacement? And for that, to get some insight, we can first look at a high-speed movie again of such event. Okay, so here I highlighted in red the colloid. This is the algae. The algae arrives exactly head-on the colloid. Okay. So what it does that the it's going to push a bit the colloid. Okay, so the colloid then reach the surface of the microorganism. Here it's going to be kicked a bit by the flagella, and then you see it kind of stay attached to the surface. And basically what the colloid does is that it moves from the front of the microorganism to the back while the microorganism is moving forward, which means that the colloid is also moving forward. Okay. And what this tells us is that the boundary conditions on the swimmer surface are super important. Okay. Here we need to have no slip boundary condition on the cell surface, okay, which means that there is a thin layer of fluid around the surface that is moving with the swimmer, okay, which is transported due to viscosity by the swimmer, and this fluid will entrain the particle, okay. Okay, so from those observations, we worked with a theoretician, Arnold Mathiesen, specialist of the hydrodynamic of microorganisms, to build an hydrodynamic model. So, well, he's done all the math and the simulation, okay, on this. The Taro model is composed of a spherical swimmer, okay, which does a time-dependent stroke, meaning that the force F that represents the flagella follows a cycle like this. Okay, this is to represent the beating of the flagella. At any time, the system is force-free, okay, so the drag force compensates the stress force. And most importantly, we have a no-slip boundary condition on this surface, which we impose basically by considering the image of the force through the sphere. Yeah. Okay, and so on average, in the swimmer's frame, you have something which is at the end quite simple. Close to the body, you have this kind of flow field, okay, with those streamlines. This is the equation for the streamlines. And the tangential velocity, the velocity along this direction, along a streamline, is given by this expression, which is quite simple, where epsilon naught here is the distance between the sphere, the minimal distance between the sphere and the streamline. Okay, and so what you should realize is that depending on the size of the colloid, okay, there is a minimal advection velocity along this direction that depends on the radius of the particle, because the particle cannot access the surface closer than its radius. Okay, this means that the larger the bead, the larger the advection around the body. Okay, and so the smaller the time it's going to take to go all around the body, okay? And so with this model, Arnold did some simulation. And so here you see a sheet of colloids. This is our swimmer that will move forward, and we'll see how this sheet of particle is disturbed, Okay, so you see the little swimmer moving, and you see that due to the no slip condition on the surface, the beads that are close to the surface, they are entrained with the microorganism. Okay? And this is without noise on the dynamics of the particle. So now let's add Brownian motion on top of this process. And here we consider three kinds of particles which have different size. Okay? So the red is the smallest, yellow middle, and blue the largest. Okay? And so we all start at the same point here, and we'll see how those different colloidal size will be entrained. And here, this is the average distance at from the starting point at which the beads are displayed. Okay. So what you should see is that the red particles, they diffuse a lot because they are small. Okay. And so they are basically left behind first. Then you have the blue one that are left behind second, and then the yellow one. Okay, as you can see, red, blue, yellow, which means that you have a non-monotonic dependency on the particle size. Okay. And so to model this effect, what we consider is some kind of Taylor dispersion. Okay, so I will enter into the detail right now. You consider the spherical swimmer here, a colloid that is in this velocity field. So this is in the frame of the swimmer, of course. Okay, so it is displaced from front to back in this velocity field. Okay, and so to model this, we change the spherical geometry to something that is straight. Okay. So we consider here the swimmer surface, okay, below epsilon equals zero. Rp, so the colloid cannot go below this epsilon. We have shear flow, okay, which is with the shear given by this expression. And the colloid diffuse in this velocity field. Okay. And the question we want to answer is what is the average time to cross from zero to this distance, which is basically this distance, okay, the distance to go all around the half sphere. And this can actually be, you can get an analytical expression for the time to cross, t. You get a cubic equation that you, that you can solve very easily. So here you have the diffusion, and this is basically the hydrodynamic part. And then you can say, okay, the entrainment length, so the total displacement of the colloid, will be the time to cross this times the velocity of the microorganism. And from this, you get those solid lines here that do not, we don't get one-to-one a perfect agreement with the simulation. Those are simulations. But the overall shape and the location of the maximum here is quite well captured through this simple model. And the quantitative difference, is, I believe, is mainly due to the fact that we went from a spherical geometry to a straight geometry. Okay. So now, looking at the experiments again, we can look at the long-time diffusivities, okay, induced by those jumps, by those entrainment even. So this is a typical trajectory of a colloid that diffuse when the algae are far away, and from time to time they are entrained quite far away from their previous position, which really spread the trajectories. This is simple Brownian motion, so without algae, over the same time. Okay, so you really see that the spreading is quite different, because here basically the effective diffusivities are much higher. So those are the normalized effective diffusivities. D naught is the Brownian motion, Brownian diffusivity. You can see that you get diffusivities which are two orders of magnitude higher than simple Brownian motion. And this is for volume fraction of algae, which are very small. Okay, so there is a really a strong effect here. And the diffusivity induced by those entrainment events can be modeled using a jump diffusion model. And it is given by this expression where T is the contact time, the time of entrainment, VS the swimming speed, S is basically the section the cross-section of the microorganism and rho just the density, the concentration of microorganism. Okay, and so this was like single colloidal dynamics, but we also looked at, let's say, macroscopic properties of those systems. And something that we've done, one of the things, is to look at the sedimentation profile of 1 micrometer bead, depending on the concentration of algae you have in the system. Okay, so you know that at equilibrium, if you don't have any algae, the steady state sedimentation profile is an exponential, okay, of minus m, which is the radius mass, okay, gz, okay, so it decreases exponentially from the bottom, okay, so this gives you a typical length, the gravitational length that you can express as the diffusion over the sedimentation speed of the colloid, okay. So now, if you look at this profile but with algae, So this is without algae, so you get an exponential. And with algae, you see that you still get exponential profile, but with characteristic lengths that depend on the concentration. Okay, the concentration of algae increases along this direction. Okay. And now if you look at this expression, if you replace d naught by df, the effective diffusivity that we've measured from the single cell, you get a new gravitational length, and which is in perfect agreement with the length here that we extract from this profile. Okay, so we have a very good agreement between the single colloidal dynamics and macroscopic properties of the system. Okay. So I'm just going to say a few words on the recent development of our question on active-passive systems. And here we've considered a confinement effect. Okay, so we have a microfluidic chip here, which is a quasi 2D, it's 15-20 micron in thickness, and whose width here increases, so from 50 to 200 micrometer. And here we have algae, which are the less bright features, and you have colloids, the brighter features. And it's different colloids that are bigger than previously. They are 10 microns, so they are only weakly brownian. Okay, so they almost don't move by themselves. And why do we consider this kind of system? It's because we know that the motion of algae becomes anisotropic close to walls. This is due to the fact that when they hit the wall, they're gonna scatter, and the way they do so means that I'm not going to enter into detail because it's a bit complicated, but basically they always get out of the wall with the same angle, okay? Which means that for some time following the scattering, they're going to swim almost parallel to the wall, okay? Which means that they spend more time swimming along the wall than in the bulk. And this is obvious when you look at the spatial distribution, so along this direction, okay, the wall being here. Okay, so they kind of spend more time here, which means that in this system you have an heterogeneous field of activity, if you want. And that's why we were interested in this kind of system. Okay, so this is the video. It's a bit boring, I would say. There's nothing much happening. But now if you look at the statistics, for example, the spatial distribution along the width here, okay, and it has been symmetrized, okay, with respect to the middle of the channel. So this is the middle of the channel, this is the wall. Those are the distribution for the algae. Okay, you see the peak that I was mentioning before. And in response to this field of algae, the colloids see that they get accumulated at the boundary, okay, and they are depleted from this region where the algal concentration is higher, okay. And we have also similar result in circular confinement. Okay, and here I just show you a little movie of the dynamics of a colloid, which is basically very similar to what we've discussed before. It's a jump diffusion process where when the algae are far away, the beads only diffuse, okay, and it only moves when it gets kicked by an algae, okay. And this is a trajectory over quite long time, 1,000 seconds, where you see so the thermal motion, some advective loop, the loops that I was mentioning before, and those kind of kick, large kick due to climates. And what you see here on these trajectories is that coids spend time moving along the boundary here, which explain the peak that we got in the distribution. Okay, and so, I'm not going to enter into the detail, but I just wanted to mention that I've managed to build a model, an analytical model, so a stochastic process, to try to explain our experimental distribution. And we get a semi-analytical expression for this, which agrees really well with the experiment. If we extract the right parameter, okay, so lambda here is basically the rate at which you get kicked, that depends on the space, okay. M1 is the first moment of the jump distribution, okay, so you have a drift close to the wall, and M2 is basically the variance of the jump distribution, okay. So using those that we can extract experimentally, we are able to fit our experimental distribution. Okay, and I just want to finish on this with a little application on this effect, on the boundary accumulation effect. So what we thought is that we could maybe separate the algae and the colloid and do a spontaneous demixing using smaller beads. So here the beads, they are smaller than the algae. And you have here side channels that can accommodate the beads but not the algae. Okay, because the beads, they tend to diffuse along the wall, we expect that they're going to be pushed inside those side channel, and you're going to separate the two kind of particles. And if you look, for example, at those side channel, see that this is indeed the case. You slowly, well, not that slowly actually, you fill those side channels and you start to empty the circular chamber, which is shown here by the surface density in the side channel that increases while the density in the chamber decreases. Okay. And this is an out of equilibrium effect. Okay. If you don't have any algae, you would not expect accumulation on the side channel. Okay, so let me conclude on this part. So we saw that microstreamer suspension enhances particle mixing through long and short range hydrodynamic interaction, but the most important is the short range interaction, those entrainment events. If you have a spatial modulation in the activity, okay, as we saw in the second part with the confinement effect, you see that you can control the preferential localization of objects, okay, by playing on the heterogeneity of the activity field. And it can be useful because you can separate things as we have shown. Okay, so again, I have a publication on this, and the second part on the confinement is still ongoing. We have not. We want to do another experiment just to be really complete, and so the paper is still in preparation. Okay, so I'm gonna drink a bit. I'm going to now talk about the project I have started and that I would like to continue. And so those projects deal with collective behaviors of microalgae. So we're still going to talk about Chlamydomonas reinhardtii, which is a system that I really like. So my collective behavior of microalgae in response to stressful stimuli. Okay, I'm not going to enter yet into what those pictures are, but let's just say that we are going to consider chemical stress. So we're going to basically add some chemicals that will interfere with the metabolism of the cells. Okay, so it can inhibit the photosynthesis, can induce oxidative stress, and so on. And we're going to consider light stress as well. So, I mean, what are the motivations for looking at this kind of problem? Well, I would say that, first of all, I mean, it's twofold. And first of all, microalgae, phytoplankton, they occupy more and more part in our societies. Okay, so they are used in food industry, in medicine, to produce drugs. But there are also thought about good alternative to fossil fuel. Okay, because basically they produce a lot of lipids inside their body, which can be used instead of fossil fuel. To summarize very quickly. But a big challenge in this industry at the moment is manipulating and harvesting the biomass. My point is that in those bioreactors, the volume fraction of cell that you can reach it will never exceed 1 or 2%, a few percent. Okay, so you have a big mass of water that you want to get rid of. Okay, if you want to get the oil from the cells. Okay, and this step is at the moment very costly, energetically and financially. Okay, just separating the biomass from the water. And the second motivation, it's much more fundamental. It's on the more on biology side, is trying to get some insight into a transition that is really not well understood from unicellular organism to a multicellular organism in the evolution, okay, which is one of the major transitions in the evolution. And Chlamydomonas belongs to a family which is a model system, okay, to study this transition, because it encompasses species of increasing complexity, okay, towards fully multicellular organism like Volvox. Okay. So, if we come back to the project, let's first look at the chemical stress, the effect of chemical stress. So, in population of microalgae, if you add this kind of chemical stress, what you're gonna impose. Is the aggregation of the population. Okay, you're going to start to form those aggregates. It can take a very big sizes, and that seems to protect the cells against the stress. Okay, and there's some kind of unity leads to strength. Okay, and this topic is also something that is. Well, it's a topic that Antoine Danon at IBPS, so he's a biologist that has moved recently at IBPS nearby. So he works on this on those problematics he has been working for the past 5 years on this, and we have started a collaboration together. The question I have is, okay, so how do they do this? How do they form those aggregates? What are the physical mechanisms involved in this process? Can somehow this could be used to harvest the biomass? Because the point here is that you concentrate naturally the system, so which should make it easier to manipulate. But for this, you also need to quantify the mechanical properties of the aggregate, because you're going to manipulate them, so you need to assess the cohesiveness of those. And of course, the effect of external fluid flows, both on the formation of the aggregate, is there external feed flows that might help actually the aggregation, but it can also break the aggregate. So I think it's an interesting effect to study. And just I'm just going to show you. It's quite difficult project that I did not realize at the beginning. But well, it's a biological system, so they don't always do what you want them to do. So this is a preliminary experiment where at t equals zero, we put some chemical, rose bengal. It interferes with the photosynthesis. Okay, so it blocks kind of the metabolism of the cells. And this is a long time time lapse over 33 hours. Okay, So you see that at the beginning, the cells, they are still quite active. So they just move around. And then they kind of stop. I mean, they reduce their motion. Here you can see that they are much more fixed. And they can they start to interact, okay, making little aggregate. Those aggregates can also move, catch up with others, so merge and grow. Okay. And at some point, the movie stopped because the time-lapse stopped, so I don't have the next part of the dynamics. Okay. But well, basically, I would like to understand this process in detail and the mechanical properties of those. And so the second part of the project will deal with light stress. Okay. So we're talking about phytoplankton. Okay, they are photosynthetic organisms, so they strive. They need light and they strive for light. So if you would leave a flask or whatever, a container with a suspension next to a window, you will see that they will accumulate towards the window. Okay, this is called phototaxy, and this is phototaxy towards the light. Okay, it goes towards the light. The thing is, light can also be harmful. Okay, this is schematized in this plot, where you see the rate of photosynthesis as a function of light intensity. Okay, this rate saturates; they cannot absorb as much light as they want, and the rest of the light, okay, is going to be harmful for them. It can destroy the photosynthetic apparatus, for example. Okay, and so above a certain light intensity. I mean, this means that it's all a question of balance. Okay, you need light, but you don't want it too much. And so, if you have a larger intensity, no, a bigger intensity, you would observe negative phototaxy. Okay, so away from the light. And the question that I was wondering is, okay, I mean, studies of phototaxy of microorganisms, it has been quite a lot studied, even if it's still not very well understood. But it's always, people always consider very dilute suspension, where at the end there is no collective behavior that appears. So I wanted to look at situation where you could maybe have collective behavior. And the setup I built is very simple. You have a petri dish here, which is 10 centimeters wide in diameter, a smaller petri dish containing the population of microalgae. And the light here is too strong for the cells, okay? So it's stressful, even at the center. So what the algae will do is that they're going to migrate towards the center. But as they migrate toward the center, they concentrate because the radius gets smaller, okay? And so we'll see what happens on this movie. So at t equals zero, we shine on the light. They migrate and they start forming those beautiful branching patterns where the density is really high. Okay. And it seems to me that they gain some collective protection by being in those big clusters because light is absorbed there. Okay. They receive no more light. And the mechanism I'm thinking about is to lead to this kind of pattern is phototaxy in a light field that is coupled to the local density field because of absorption and diffusion of light by cells. Okay. So that would be represented, well, that could maybe be modeled with this kind of advection diffusion equation, where the advection speed depends on the intensity and the gradient of intensity, and the intensity is a function of the density field. Okay. So, I'm a bit above the time, I guess, but I only have like 3 slides left. So here, I show you the effect of the first experiment we've done, looking at different control parameter, which first is the cell concentration. You can see that the patterns are similar, but there are quantitative differences. For example, the width of the branch. And so we started to quantify the dynamics here. And one thing that we looked at for, for example, is the retraction speed. Okay, so at which speed those fingers they retract here, okay, which is shown here, depending on the cell density. And you can see that here you have a linear dependency. Okay, so you have a constant speed of retraction that you can plot as a function of cell concentration. Well, we don't have many points, but to me it seems that there are like two kinds of regime, okay, with different speed. And looking at the morphology of the pattern, it seems that the speed here is correlated to, for instance, the width of the pattern. So something that I would be interested in, well, I'm interested in at the moment, is to quantify the speed versus the branch width. Okay. And why I'm saying this also is because basically the dynamics of the finger is mainly set by what happens at the interface. Because inside the cluster, the cell they move completely randomly because they don't do any phototaxis anymore. Okay, and this is exemplified by this movie, where it's at the very end of the process. So this is basically the central blob. Okay, and this is a finger that is retracting. And the movie here has been done by taking the standard deviation, okay, of the images to over 10 images to have the little trace representing the motion of the algae. Okay, and you see with this kind of movie, you see where it moves and where it doesn't move. Okay, and as you can see, so the cells, they go in the cluster, and at the interface, there are some cells that go out, okay, just due to random motion. And when they go out, then they go back in, okay, due to phototaxis, because the ray of light, they're coming like this. Okay, so all the dynamics happens, the interesting dynamics happens in this region. Okay, and to summarize a bit what happens in globally in this this kind of pattern, is that you're gonna have cells that enter into the finger, so you can densify it here. You have those excursions due to random motion, but the cells, they will re-enter later on in those fingers, or join later in the blob here. But you can also have branch-branch interaction, because the cell that goes out here, it can join, in fact, this branch. Okay, so you have some coupling between nearby branches. Okay, and well, a question that I have is, can we define an interfacial tension for between the dense phase and the dilute phase? Okay, and can we use this interfacial tension to then model the dynamics of the retraction of this kind of finger? Okay, and to to study this, what I would do is looking at the fluctuation of the interface. Okay, and quantifying the fluctuation of the interface. Okay, so I'm going to stop here. And I would like just to acknowledge the work of the people. We've done the project on active passive mixtures. So Marco Pauline, mainly, and Idan Tuval, who were my supervisor at Warwick and IMIDEA, and the people I've collaborated with. That's it. Thank you for your attention. Thank you. And just to, I'm just going to put a bonus video, okay, which is also very nice, where the setup has just been changed slightly, where the light now shines towards the top. So the cells, they migrate at the top, okay, and so they form those beautiful dynamical pattern. Because here there is phototaxis and bioconvection. Well, that's it. Any question?
Okay, merci.
Merci. Je voulais savoir, là, pour la première partie que tu nous as montrée sur les modèles avec les collisions de colloïdes sur les algues.
Ouais.
Dans ce que tu as fait, est-ce que tu as finalement besoin du champ de vitesse d'une algue, ou est-ce que ça marche au final juste avec, si on prend une autre particule, entre guillemets, qui aurait un mouvement où elle avance et
puis bien sûr. Déplace. Non, tu as complètement raison. Si tu avais une particule, tu tires dessus, ça entraînerait les particules autour. Okay. La seule chose qui change quantitativement, c'est que... où est ma souris ? C'est que ici, tu as un terme, en gros, ce G de lambda, c'est un terme qui modèle la position des flagelles. Donc, c'est un terme géométrique, mais c'est juste une petite, un petit changement, quoi. Mais effectivement, ces lignes de courant ici sont exactement les mêmes que si tu as pour une bille qui est tirée, quoi.
Assez proche de celle d'Axel en fait.
Ouais.
Est-ce que tu as regardé du coup, est-ce qu'il y a un temps caractéristique de détachement quand la particule arrive à l'arrière du coup de la cellule, est-ce qu'il y a un moment où elle reste attachée ou elle se détache de manière quasi
C'est-à-dire qu'elle n'est jamais attachée.
Ok.
C'est vraiment un truc continu quoi, juste la bille elle va parcourir tout ça.
J'avais l'impression que sur les films, en fait, il y avait un moment où elle restait
attachée. Ouais, non. En fait, le truc, c'est que c'est pas symétrique, je pense. C'est parce que ici, t'as un point de stagnation.
Ouais.
Ok. Et donc, qu'en fait, elle va passer plus de temps dans la partie avant que la partie arrière. C'est pas symétrique, en fait, là. Et aussi, sur le film, ce que tu vois, c'est que. Donc, effectivement. En fait, elle passe plus de temps donc à l'avant, puis là aussi, il y a les flagelles qui influent un petit peu, elle se fait un peu taper et tout. Donc. Voilà. Ouais.
Merci.
Une autre question ? Et du coup, en fait, c'est quand même assez peu dense, et dans le... En fait, l'interaction seule... C'est une chlamydiae qui fait bouger les choses. Les autres sont beaucoup trop loin, en fait.
Ouais.
D'accord. Donc, il n'y a pas d'effet vraiment collectif des autres, en fait, sur...
Non.
C'est pas assez dense, mais tu dis que c'est, en fait, comme ça dans la nature, puisque c'est comme ça dans les réacteurs.
Ouais, exactement. Les systèmes de micro-algues, c'est toujours très peu concentré. Donc, c'est toujours dans des limites diluées.
Pas diluées, OK.
Ouais.
Et justement... Une espèce de réacteur rond avec des tuyaux qui sortent, c'est des sorties comment ça, c'est quoi le sens en fait de cet objet là? Oui, celui qui est là juste avant.
Ça?
Ouais. C'est un réservoir avec des tuyaux qui sortent, c'est ça?
En fait, j'ai peut-être pas passé assez de temps dessus, c'était un peu rapide. Ça c'est une chambre microfluidique.
Ouais.
Ça fait, je crois, 200 micromètres de diamètre, là. Ça fait à peu près 7-8 microns de large. Et la hauteur, c'est 15-20 microns. D'accord ? Donc, on est en quasi 2D, là. Et juste là, on laisse évoluer le système. Il n'y a pas d'écoulement, il n'y a rien du tout. Et pourquoi on a fait ça ? C'est parce que, vu qu'on s'est aperçu que les colloïdes, t'en as passé du temps, juste à diffuser le long des murs, on s'est dit qu'on devrait les pousser petit à petit dans ces canaux et séparer les deux types d'objets.
D'accord, donc c'est des canaux qui sont fermés en fait, et c'est juste...
Ouais, voilà, c'est des impasses.
Ouais, d'accord, c'est avec sa petite nage qu'il va frôler la paroi tout le temps et puis il va rentrer, donc il va sortir.
Ouais.
Ok. D'accord.
Du coup, c'est plus une question de bio.
Ouais.
Est-ce que, du coup, tu as vu que tes algues, elles aident à finalement diffuser plus rapidement des particules qui n'ont pas de moteur.
Ouais.
Est-ce que tu sais s'il y a des systèmes dans la nature qui, du coup, ont fait une espèce de coévolution pour se servir un peu de cette surdiffusivité des algues ?
C'est une super question. Y a un papier qui est sorti il n'y a pas très longtemps qui montre exactement ça. Qu'il y a des petites bactéries, elles font ils appellent ça hitchhiking, okay, sur des plus grosses, des micro-organismes qui sont plus gros et qui eux sont motiles, et donc ça leur permet justement d'explorer plus d'environnement dans un temps fini quoi. Donc ouais, c'est des choses qui existent vraiment. Et nous on avait essayé de regarder si on pouvait entraîner des bactéries mais qui sont aussi motiles. Mais juste parce qu'elles sont plus petites. J'avais vu deux trois événements d'entraînement Mais c'est tellement rare, parce qu'il faut que la bactérie arrive au bon moment que du micro-organisme. Et ça arrive quasi jamais. Mais c'était des questions qu'on s'était aussi posées.
Très bien. Encore merci.
Merci à vous.